Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of God, the Beneficent, the Merciful. Well, I'm going to quickly run down this rebuttal because, you know, I'm not reading notes, unfortunately. But Pastor Rudolph has come with, you know, like an essay of notes. But I'm hoping that the 15 minutes is enough to, you know, demystify everything that Pastor Rudolph said. Pastor Rudolph said, there is only one God. And he said there are three eternal persons described in Scripture, the Father, Son, and the Spirit. And their deity is evident. And my reply to that is, Rudolph, Pastor Rudolph, I don't know from which Bible you are talking about that these things are evident. Because from the Bible that I read and from the Bible that you have, these things do not exist. And it's like, you know, trying to make orange juice using apples. It doesn't make sense. You cannot bring these things out of the Bible. The Bible is very clear that God is one and unique. And you cannot use the Bible to derive or to go at such, you know, a doctrine, which is the, you know, triune doctrine. It's like, you know, taking a bus and putting people in a bus going to Zimbabwe. I have some Zimbabwean friends who are here with us today and expecting that they will get to Cape Town. So it doesn't make sense. If you put somebody in a bus going to Cape Town, he will go to Cape Town. If you don't expect him to find him in Zimbabwe. So this is one thing that I find Pastor Rudolph's logical consistency is not one of his strong points. We go to the second thing that Pastor Rudolph mentioned, and this is chapter 28. And verse 19, and he said this baptismal formula is, you know, triune. And we read from the Encyclopedia of the Catholics, the Catholic Encyclopedia 2, we read page 263, and it says the baptismal triune formula, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. When it says that go, chapter 28, verse 19, of the book of Matthew, it says go and make disciples of the world, baptizing them by the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. This did not exist in the Bible. This is an addition, and any person, I'm actually disappointed because I hope Pastor Rudolph is one of the scholars or at least a student of knowledge. You cannot quote this verse because all Christians know, and it's in your encyclopedias, that this is a later addition and it's not the Word of God. This is very clear as it has been stated in the Catholic Encyclopedia. We also know that I'm going to give another challenge today, and because the first 5,000 rand has just been ignored, I'm going to add another 5,000 rand. If this verse is actually true, chapter 28, verse 19 of the book of Matthew, I want a single verse because Jesus commands his disciples in this verse. He says, go and make disciples and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. If you give me a single verse from the book of Acts of the Apostles, or from the book of Matthew to the book of Revelation, where the disciples used this formula and baptized people by the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Rudolph, you're shaking your head. You understand what I'm saying. So I hope you take the 5,000 home. I want a verse where the disciples baptized using this name. Another problem that comes with this verse that he quoted is that, you know, the Father has a name. As he quoted, he said Yahweh or Jehovah. This is the name of the Father. The Son is Yeshua or Jesus, a renowned name. Everybody knows who Jesus is. But what is the name of the Holy Spirit? The Christians don't know, the Muslims know. So we can set up another meeting where we can teach you who the Holy Spirit is. Because you worship him, but you don't know his name. And if you know the name, another 5,000 rand. We are going to 10,000 rand now. If you give me the name of the Holy Spirit, you know, this is just free money flying around. So that is one thing. Another problem is that the Father has a throne according to the Bible, and it says the Son has a throne, which is Jesus. And this throne is not just for Jesus. It's not unique to Jesus. Because if we read chapter 19, verse 27 of the book of Matthew, we find out that the 12 disciples will sit in 12 different thrones. But the Holy Spirit does not have a throne. Give me a verse in the Bible which says that the Holy Spirit has a throne. So they cannot be co-equal. They cannot be, you cannot term them as being co-equal. And then he says that Jesus being the eternal Son of God. This is the most contradictory sentence that anybody can make up. This sentence is deformed in so many levels. Because what is begetting? What is a son? A son is begat. You beget a son. For example, a few months ago I had a son. A son is begat in time, right? What does eternally mean? Eternally transpasses time, matter, space. Doesn't have a beginning, doesn't have an end. So you can, how can you procreate eternally? It doesn't make sense. This in the English grammar will be an incomprehensible speech. You'd be speaking in tongues if you say that Jesus is the eternal Son of God, because eternal and son cannot be put in the same sentence. Because being this is, you know, a logical inconsistency. Again, it is illogical, it is paradoxical, and it is incoherent, incomprehensible in all aspects. You cannot eternally procreate. We go to the next point. Tell me if I have 10 minutes. I have 10 minutes. Okay, you're going to add me the minute you just spoke. So we Muslims disagree with whatever Pastor Rudolph just preached to us, the triune God. Why? Because it's not in the Bible, it's not in the Quran. This is something that is a doctrine that he brought up, or people before him brought up. It is something the Quran says in chapter 9, verse 30. يُضَاهِئُونَ قَوْلَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. They just take the words that were used by the people who you know, disbelieved before them. But it's not in the Bible. It cannot be found in the Bible, just like we explained earlier. Because if you say that the Son gave up, according to the book of Philippians chapter 2 verse 5, says that the Son was in the nature of God and he didn't find that nature being something to hold on to. That is what Philippians chapter 2 verse 5 says. And he came down as a servant, so he gave up his being God. So he's no longer God. We don't have a God anymore, because the God, you know, came down and he gave up his essential divine nature. And if you give up those your essence, which are the properties which are necessary for your existence, then you no longer are defined as a God. So Jesus being ceased being a God, or God ceased being a God. This is again paradoxical and illogical in so many, you know, levels. And to say it quite frankly, it's a pagan idea. Many people have said this about it. Unitarian Christians have said this is a pagan idea, not Muslims. So if you're going to go after anyone, go after your fellow Christians who are Unitarians. One more question is, I'd like to ask, if Jesus was God and he didn't find being God something, tell me if I have 5 minutes, he didn't find God being a God something to hold on to, and he came down as a man, that means he came down temporarily for your salvation and to die for your sins. Then we look at the book of Acts of the Apostles, chapter 7, verse 55. Being led by the Holy Spirit, the disciple looked into the skies and he saw what? Jesus sitting at the right hand of God, standing by the right hand side of God, which we would call Ashabul Yameen, meaning Jannah to us Muslims. But the Christians believe it as, you know, you need to learn a lot of things from the Muslims. They think it's the actual hand of God. So, Jesus is a man. He said he saw the Son of Man being led by the Holy Spirit. If Jesus took on the flesh to come only to this earth, then why is he flesh up in heaven? And when he comes back, he says that he is still going to be flesh and bones. So, where is his divine nature? Where is the Word? He was a Word before. Why didn't he go back to being the Word? Why is he still flesh and bones in heaven? If you want to put him in the Trinity as a triune God. So I'm not going to use fancy words as the article the brother was reading, Pastor Rudolph. We're going to go to the next argument. The next argument that Pastor Rudolph brought up, let me go through this very quickly. He says the Bible describes three persons. We already said that does not exist, and we offered many. We're hoping to hear back from him. Each member works equally, he said. This is This does not make sense. Any person who has read two verses from the Bible knows that Jesus is not equal to God. Chapter 14, verse 28 of the book of John says, the Father is greater than I. So Jesus, the Father is greater than Jesus. You know, we have the signs in mathematics. You know this sign, it means what? Greater than, lesser than. So these are things that you're supposed to comprehend very easily. Jesus says the Father is greater than I. Jesus does not have any knowledge. Jesus, in the book of Luke chapter 8 verse 40, I have 5 minutes. In the book of chapter 8 verse 40, going down to 44, a woman with hemorrhage came and she touched his, you know, he was wearing, just like today, unfortunately I'm not wearing it, but the fellow Muslims are wearing it. Jesus was wearing that and she touched him from the back, and what happened? You know, Jesus lost his, I'm not going to say it like that, but he said, who touched me? He didn't know who touched him. In the book of Mark chapter 11, Jesus did not know the season of the figs. In chapter 13 verse 32 of the book of Mark, Jesus says, I do not know the hour. He doesn't know the hour. Jesus does not know the day of judgment. Chapter 24 verse 36 of the book of Matthew, Jesus does not know the hour. So he doesn't have knowledge. He cannot be God, and he cannot be co-equal with God. And we can say so about, so I'm going to, there are many things that I haven't handled, but I'm going to the three categories of Tawheed. Thank you very much, Pastor Rudolph, for mentioning this. I would encourage you to keep studying Islamic from Islamic sources. These are not, you cannot compare the three, you know, categories of Tawheed with the three deities that you have. These are, you know, simply, we can say the power of God, we can say the knowledge of God, and we can say that these things are completely exclusive and they are separate things. And this Tawheed, as we are told in chapter 4, verse 83, I don't have time to read the whole verse, لَعَلِمَ الَّذِينَ يَسْتَنْبِطُونَهُ, that God tells us that the people who derive these teachings from the Quran know these things. And we can derive these three concepts from one verse. We told you to derive the Trinity from one verse, and we give you 5,000 rand today. We can derive it from the verse of chapter 19, verse 65. Of the Quran, which says, Rabbu samawati wal ard, the Lord of the heavens and the earth. That is the Tawheed of Rububiyyah. Rabbu samawati wal ard, wa ma baynahuma, and everything that exists between it. Fa'buduh, this is Tawheed uluhiyyah, that you should worship him, wastabil li'ibadati, and be steadfast in his worship. So we have the two categories. What do I have? So we have two categories of Tawheed. The third category, it says, this is one verse, رَبُّ السَّمَوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا فَاعْبُدْهُ وَاسْتَبِرْ لِعْبَادَتِهِ هَلْ تَعْلَمُ لَهُ سَمِيًّا. The third is Asma wa Sifat. So these three, I've brought them down for you very clearly. I've derived them from you from one verse. I can derive it from the very first chapter of the Quran, Surah Al-Fatiha. I can derive it from the very last chapter, chapter 114 of the Quran, Surah Al-Nas. I can derive these three, you know, categories of Tawheed, but you failed miserably to provide evidence for this. From, he says, the eternal Quran which exists with Allah. We believe that the Quran is the Kalam al-Azali, which is from God. God speaks, and the speech of God, you can tell us if he's saying that the Quran, being the speech of God, is a separate entity that exists eternally other than God. This does not make sense. And he quoted the Ash'ari and the Mu'tazilites. The time is very limited, but if you give us the time, I'm ready to debate this text with you. I'm ready to do that even after this debate. If you'd like, we can take a cup of coffee and I can explain a few things to you about this. So the Kalam al-Azali of God, this is like the speech of God, which is uncreated. Kalam Allah, غير مخلوق. It is not created. That is the Quran. He continues to say that the solitary divine cannot be loved. He is saying that God alone cannot be loved. He needs people to love, so that it doesn't make sense. Because if you are alone in the desert, then what happens? Do you stop being a loving person? You don't stop being a loving person just because you don't have a person to love. This does not make sense. And if you start adding up other partners to God, why stop at three? Why say that three is the, you know, the place to stop? You can go to 1,000 just like the Indians have. Why? He says the qualification of love is different from the Quran, because the Quran says the qualification, the Bible says that God is love, and the Quran qualifies you know, you have to have certain qualities for God to love you. That is not true. Because the formula in which the Quran starts with is Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of God, the one I just used right now, in the name of God, the most compassionate, the merciful. So God is compassionate and loving. God is Al-Wadud. And if we read the book of Psalms chapter 5 verse 6, if we read the book of Psalms chapter 11 verse 5, Leviticus chapter 20 verse 23, Deuteronomy chapter 18 verse 12, we read the book of Leviticus chapter 26 verse 30, we read the book of Ecclesiastes chapter 3 verse 8, we find that God says he does not love the wicked. So this is the Bible. You're saying God is love. And here in the Bible, in so many verses I've quoted, I can give you 100 verses. It says that God does not love certain groups of people. So this means that your argument is inconsistent, and I am willing, it's time. So I am willing to give you the, what are we at right now? 15,000. If you prove to me the few things that, and I hope you quoted them, because last time I asked and you didn't reply to anything I said. So I don't want to go home with this money. Thank you.
Thanks for everyone. The reason I didn't make any statement on his opening argument is because I had to give my opening argument, so now we can do the rebuttals. But when we look at the understanding of what I tried to negate, what I was trying to say in my 3 points was simply the following. When we look at the actual essence of Allah, he is not known by his very own essence, and even Islamic scholars say that. And therefore, if Allah is other, he cannot express his love in the same manner in what we express it, because he is other. He is above his arsh. He's beyond his attributes. And that is what I said. It has an impact on his knowability, the way we perceive him, that which we perceive God to be, he is not. Remember, I said that. There was nothing said about that, nor was it addressed. Let me also say that when we speak about the essential understanding of that, in his opening argument, he mentioned that the Creator shares his essence with the creation. We are saying it's not inconsistent with the idea that we find amongst Muslims. When we look at Muslims, we can see quite clearly that they also believe in liberation. They believe that the Quran became book, and therefore we have the eternal Quran that is expressed in a book. Here's my study Quran, forgive me, it's got post-notes in it, because I read it often, I read it every day. But that book is not the eternal speech of Allah. That which is contained in that book is eternal, but that which is printed is temporal. So do we have a contradiction? No, we've got two spheres. We've got an eternal sphere, and we've got a created sphere, and that is in no contradiction of the eternality of the Quran itself and its uncreatedness. That's exactly what we say when it comes to the hypostatic union. When we look at the hypostatic union, afford us the same. The eternal word of God became flesh, he dwelt amongst ordinary men, and we beheld his glory with us. So there's nothing contrary to what we believe. We heard the following being said. We heard, we heard the following being said. We heard that in Mark chapter 12 verse 29, in actual fact, there's a statement that have been made, ultimately, that the rich young ruler is affirming the unity of God. Absolutely. Christians are not saying there's three gods. The greatest command is the Shema. But yes, please read a little bit further. Read in verse 35 to 37. Jesus in verse 35 and 37 of Mark chapter 12 is affirming his deity. You said again, show me a passage that says one being three persons. Muslims commonly assumes that the Old Testament affirms absolute Unitarianism. And what we are simply saying is that is not the case. Often we will hear, show me a passage where this says one being in three persons. I'm going to turn the tables on you tonight and ask the following. Can you show us a scripture that says God is one being and one person? And let me say, that passage does not exist. Because we both are using articulated positions that we are saying by our own speech, which is deduced from our perspective and religious texts. The language that the disciples used to describe the unity of God and the Old Testament patriarchs is not the same as today. Language grows, and therefore we use language today as we know it to describe our own individual positions. Therefore, the demand that is placed to explicitly articulate a position is simply illogical and inconsistent with the demand that was placed on the text, and I would say even with the Quran. We heard it said also that God cannot die and God cannot be ignorant, and we hear all these questions. Let me sum it up. The question pertaining to the dual nature of Christ was, I think, very well articulated in the beginning of my introduction. If you say the person of Jesus Christ cannot embody two radical different perspectives, one of immanent infinitude and one of transcendent infinitude, you just do not know the God of the Bible, which is Jesus Christ. But even further than that, if you deny the dual nature of Christ, you also lose the God of the Old Testament. Why am I saying that? Let me give you a scripture. Let me give you an example. Example he used. He said, God cannot change his mind. Numbers 23, verse 19. By the way, that speaks of the surety of God's decree, not the ontology of his nature. But when we look at the scripture, we can see quite clearly that in Exodus 32, verse 14, Psalms 106, verse 45, it says that God does change his mind. So what do we have? Do we have a radical contradiction? No. We have one God that occupies two radically different perspectives. One is the director of history and one is the actor in it. It's the same God with two different perspectives. This God of the Old Testament dwells with his people in the tabernacle, but also transcends the tabernacle, much like Jesus' incarnation in the New Testament. Therefore, biblical Trinitarians therefore believe that the New Testament revelation of Jesus Christ is the culmination of the Old Testament and not a deviation from it. And this is important to understand. We heard John 14, 28. The Father is greater than I. And let me just say this. I wish we had time to go into this, because when we look at the Trinity, and like I described, in the economy of the Trinity, there is different tasks. But here's the thing. In our mindset, in the Christian Bible, just because there's a difference in function amongst the triune persons of God, it does not mean that there's an inferiority of nature. In John 14, verse 28, Jesus speaks in this chapter about his ontological union with the Father and shows that he's also in submission to the Father, according to verse 28. That's what we expect when we read about the incarnation, Philippians chapter 2. But we note that he mentions in verse 12 of that same chapter that his disciples will do greater works than him. Does this mean that his disciples are ontologically superior to Jesus? Absolutely not. This passage speaks of the economic superiority of the Father to the Son in accomplishing the task of salvation, like I described in the beginning. God enacts both leadership in the Father and submission in the Son. We hear the scripture being quoted, John 17, verse 3, in your opening argument, that only one true God. Remember my definition of the Trinity. I clearly stated that there is a clear distinction between Father, Son, and Spirit, and that is what we see in John 17, verse 3. It shows that Jesus equally necessary in position of salvation for both the Son and the Father. And Muslims, usually when they quote that scripture, I always used to say, do you really have the Son as described in the scripture? Because if you don't, you will die in your sin. That's what Jesus says in John 8, verse 24. But listen to this. When we look at John 17, verse 3, it says in verse 5 that Jesus mentions that he pre-existed with the Father, actually, not notionally. There's a personal pronoun in the Greek called parasoi, which denotes and speaks of even before the world began. In John 6, verse 62, Jesus affirms against his divine heavenly occupation before the incarnation. Also know that Jesus possesses the divine prerogatives and the divine name of God in verse 10 and 11 of John 17. Jesus also sanctifies himself in verse 19 of John 17, and he shows quite clearly that he emanates with the glory of Yahweh. But Yahweh says in Isaiah 42 verse 18, I will share my glory with no one. But Jesus claims that glory. Why does Jesus do it? Because he's one with the Father. We can also see quite clearly that this Jesus is therefore not an ordinary man. You see, this passage of scripture that is quoted in John chapter 14. We heard portions being said like, can you show me a Trinitarian chapter and a Trinitarian passage? Well, let me read you one. Okay, in John chapter 14, verse 15, Jesus says the following, if you love me, you'll keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. He's the Spirit of truth. Father, Spirit, Son, the world is unable to receive him because it does not see him or know him. But you do know him because he remains with you. It's not Muhammad in the future. He's going to remain with the actual disciples at that very time. He remains with you and he will be in you. And that is definitely not Muhammad unless he's pre-existing. Again, I will not leave you as orphans, Jesus says. I will come to you. So when we use scriptures, listen. Text without context is pretext. We cannot use little passages of scripture to derive doctrines from it. We also heard it being said Jesus is not really explicitly known as God. Let me say this. You know, in the book of Acts, we heard the book of Acts being mentioned. Let me say this. We call on the name of Jesus to be saved, according to the scriptures. We get baptized in his name. We call on his name to give to get things work in our providential favor. We call on his name to cast out demons and to heal people. He's the one that will ultimately judge the living and the dead. All power, dominion is given to him forever and ever. And his name is above every name. And that is all recognized in the New Testament. But why does nobody then just simply say, sorry guys, he was not God? Scripture makes it clear often, over and over again, that this Jesus was more than a mere man. Let me look at a few scriptures. I'm going to not use notes because I was sort of accused that I'm using notes, but I just type quick. Okay. But let me look at a few passages of scripture that have been mentioned. We heard the passage of scripture mentioned in Galatians chapter 3, and we hear the following being said. We said that Galatians chapter 3 verse 20 describes or derives a reality that is ultimately unknown to us. Let me read to you what Galatians chapter 4 says. That's a chapter just after what was actually mentioned. And it says the following, again in verse 4. But when the completion of time came, God sent his son born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, so that we might receive adoption as sons. And because we are sons, God has sent his spirit. There's another triune passage of scripture. Father, Spirit, Son in union, working out our salvation in time. We heard another passage of scripture mentioned. I hope I get to all of it. In 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 5. And we hear it said, you see, he was just a man. Jesus was just a man. This is what the passage of scripture says. Well, when you read chapter 2, please go a little bit further. We cannot chop up the Bible and use singular verses to describe full realities. Let me read to you the scripture that has been described. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, a man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom and a testimony in the proper time. What does it speak of? It speaks of the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ. It speaks of him as being the mediator before God, before man, for all of us. There's no other mediator before God. It's not Muhammad. Okay, there's no other mediator before God and man but the man Jesus Christ. But then listen a little bit further. It says the following in 1 Timothy chapter 3. It says, this man, Jesus Christ, he was manifest in the flesh, justified by the Spirit, seen by angels, preached amongst the Gentiles, believed on his glory, and taken up into glory. We hear the book of Acts being quoted, and then we hear the following being said. When you look at the book of Acts, we can see quite clearly that there's sort of a Pauline influence on all of us. Let me read to you what the apostle or the Christian church believed before the coming of Paul. So let me just give you a quick summation from the first five chapters. This is all believed and affirmed by the first Christian community before Paul. Listen, Jesus was Lord amongst them, Acts 1 verse 21. They were witnesses of his resurrection from the dead, Acts chapter 1 verse 22. Anyone calling on the name of Jesus will be saved, Acts chapter 2 verse 21. Jesus was affirmed by the Father with signs and miracles, absolutely, Acts chapter 2 verse 22. We affirm that. God the Father had a plan that Christ had to fulfill to ransom us of all our sins, Acts chapter 2 verse 23. Jesus was killed on a cross, Acts chapter 2 verse 23. See, you cannot use Acts chapter 22 at the expense of Acts chapter 23. Further, what we also see in the book of Acts is, even though you use Acts chapter 2, let me read to you the full context, because you need to understand what is actually preached here. When you look at Acts chapter 2, you can see quite clearly at Pentecost, it says the following, and he's drawing from the Old Testament scriptures, from the book of Joel, and he shows that God will pour out his spirit on all flesh. Guess what happens? Just a few verses after that, in verse 39, we can see that we call on the providential name of Jesus Christ to be saved, but it's Jesus who pours out his own spirit. What happens? Jesus is God. Jesus is the source of life, Acts chapter 3 verse 15. Jesus was foretold through the prophets of old in Acts chapter 2 verse 29. And they were actual eyewitnesses of this historical person, Jesus Christ. And let me just say to you, these historical people that have written these books affirm that he was Lord and God. It's just a fact. So, who is the Holy Spirit? We heard it being said, the Holy Spirit is sort of impersonal force. The Holy Spirit's not known by a name. Let me say something to you. When we look at the book of Acts, we're in the book of Acts, so let's stick there. We can see quite clearly that the book of Acts affirm in verse 3, Acts chapter 5 verse 3, that he's an actual person. He's disappointed. He experiences emotions. And ultimately, he smites two in the very first Christian service because they're disobedient to God. And he was not just a force. So we cannot come to the text, we cannot come to the biblical text and just affirm and say that all of these realities are present within the text, but ultimately they do not describe a reality. We hear the following scripture also read in John chapter 8, verse 40. John chapter 8, we hear the following being said about Jesus. And let me read it to you. I've got a few minutes left, so let's have fun. And I love to do exegetics. We do this with our students very often as well. John chapter 4. We heard in John chapter 8. Sorry, I'm in John chapter 4. John chapter 8. We heard the following mentioned. John chapter 8. John chapter 8, verse 40. We heard it being said that the scripture says the following: "But now you're trying to kill me because I was a man." And again we say, "You see, he was just a man." Well, read a little bit further, because in verse 58, Jesus speaks and he says emphatically, "I assure you, before Abraham was, I am, ego eimi," which draws from the Latin, from the actual Old Testament text in Isaiah 43, verse 30, where Jesus actually attributes to himself the divine name of Yahweh himself. So we cannot come to the text and we cannot say simply that ultimately when we look at the text, that the text speaks impartial about the person of Jesus Christ. We heard that the scripture, for instance, like Matthew 28, verse 9, according to the Catholic dictionary, was not in the text. Great, that's why I'm not a Catholic, because I'm not an anti-supernaturalist. When Jesus speaks in John 14, 26, he says that the sole function of the Holy Spirit will be to remind the disciples of everything he has said. What about Matthew chapter 28, verse 19? Well, we find it in Tertullian in the first century, Hippolytus, Cyprian. We find it in the Didache in the late first century. So what we find is that this scripture was already attested in the first century of the Christian church, yet the Catholic dictionary wants to tell us 2,000 years later that it wasn't the original text. Guys, I think not. I think let's go to the original sources. Further, let me just say to you that the apostles themselves affirmed the Trinity. And let me give you just four guys and four scriptures. You can write them down for those who are watching. You can also just look at it. In John's Gospel, in John chapter 1, verse 21, the whole of John chapter 1, chapter 21, verse 24, we see Peter in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16. We see Paul in Colossians 1, 16, Philippians 2, verse 2, verse 5 to 11, and Matthew's Gospel in Matthew chapter 3, verse 16 to 17. We can look at all of these scriptures, and they attest to the wonderful person of Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit, and the Father. Thank you, guys. Thank you.